Yes, hi everyone, and thanks for coming along to see my talk. My name is Jessica. I've been working at King for about 3.5 years now. I am originally from the Netherlands, as you might have guessed from my name, and I came to the UK to finish my master's thesis in econometrics, and since then I've started working at King and I never looked back, basically. So today what I'll be talking about is A/B testing in mobile games. We do a lot of A/B testing, and I'd like to give you some ins and outs and things we've learned. Hopefully you'll be able to do some cool experiments yourselves in your own products. So I'm going to start a little bit more general about what is it like to be a data scientist at King and what kind of work we do. So I'd like to see a show of hands. Who here knows or has played this game? Yes, that's what I thought quite a lot. So this is Candy Crush, and this is basically where the success of King kind of took off in a big way. But it's definitely not the only game that we develop at King. We have a whole load of other games, bigger and smaller ones. A few to mention, maybe Diamond Digger Saga. We do Blossom Blast Saga. Bubble Witch 3 is another big one that we have. Pet Rescue Saga is an older game that is still doing quite well that we're very proud of. But what I'd like to talk to you about today is mostly around the Farm Heroes franchise. So this is a franchise that's being developed in the London studio and that I work a lot on. This franchise started with Farm Hero Saga, the original game, which launched a little over 5 years ago. And it's been a very successful game. We're very proud of this. It has made over $1 billion since launching 5 years ago, which is quite exceptional if you think about the fact that this is a free-to-play game. So players do not have to pay to download the game, but still they enjoyed it so much that they spend money in it and they spend a lot of time on it. So we're very proud of that. But there are other games in this franchise as well, one of which is called Farm Hero Super Saga. It's a slightly smaller game. However, it does a lot of work that is beneficial to the rest of the company. One of the things that we do a lot in Farm Hero Super Saga is experimentation with advertisements. And this has been super helpful for all of our bigger games, basically, where we implement learnings from this smaller game and we roll them out to bigger games such as Candy Crush or Farm Hero Saga. A more recent launch that we've had was Farm Heroes Champions. This has only been released in the UK for about a month, I think. And it's a little bit more focused on bringing players a social experience. So we're doing lots of experimentation around that in that game, which is also very exciting. So what is it like to be a data scientist at King and what kind of work we do? So it is very important for us to focus on player behavior. Sometimes we have this idea of data science is all about making the money. However, what we really try to focus in on is understanding what players do and why they behave in a certain way in our game. And this is what we believe truly helps us to make better games and help us understand better what we can do to make them more fun and more engaging. So some questions that we might be solving is, why is this, are players engaging or not engaging with a particular feature that we've released? Why are players leaving our game? And can we predict that before they actually do leave? What is the best way to interact with our players in terms of marketing and CRM? Those are kind of good questions that we feel like are really helping us understand our players and how to interact with them better. Now, what I want to focus on today is A/B testing, because we do a lot of historical data analysis in our game. So we track millions and millions of events every day of what players do in our game, which is very interesting, and we can learn a lot from that, and we can form some great hypotheses using this historical data analysis. But usually once we have some hypotheses, we want to verify them, and that's where we get to A/B testing. So why do we run A/B testing in our games? We think A/B testing helped us a lot in creating some amazing player experiences, but as any kind of method, it comes with its cost and benefits. So firstly, A/B testing can be a very quick and accurate way to make decisions and to create insights into what players enjoy in our games. Random selection is a very important part. So when we do historical analysis, we tend to deal with external factors that might influence how players behave and interact with a new feature or a test. And we cannot control for that. Whereas when we do A/B testing, we randomly select players and put them into control and treatment group, which means that we control for these other factors. It's a great way of making data-driven decisions. If we don't do A/B testing and don't make data-driven decisions, it's very, even the most impartial decision maker has some sort of personal biases that can influence their decisions. And A/B testing is a very good way of kind of trying to eliminate that bias and make well-informed decisions. And finally, A/B testing in generally is a quick way of getting some very helpful learnings and some data about how your feature is performing, whereas historical analysis might take up a lot of time. So by doing A/B testing, that can help free up some data sciences time to work on other interesting projects. The negatives, however, is that it can be quite costly and also risky to do A/B tests. The biggest one there is opportunity costs. So when you try to, usually when you want to run an A/B test, it's about some sort of new feature improvement that you want to implement in your game. And you believe that that is an improvement and that is better than what you had. So if that's the case, rolling it out to only a part of your players means that you're losing out on some impact, on some revenue that you might get from that. So that's an opportunity cost that's involved with A/B testing that is important to take into account in a business context. Another problem that you might have, especially when dealing with limited sample sizes, is that you might not be able to detect the effect size that you're after. If you want to get, for example, a 1% uplift in, let's say, conversions, which is not very common in a free-to-play game, that might be difficult to detect even if you have quite a big sample size. Whereas if you want to look at, let's say, game rounds, we have a ton of observations on game rounds, that might be a lot easier. So that's important to take into account, and I'll talk a little bit more about how to deal with that later in the presentation. And finally, setting up an A/B testing framework might be costly and difficult in the beginning. Once you've got it all set up, it will enable you to run tons of A/B tests very quickly, but it's a significant time and resource investment to set this framework up when you're just starting out. So that's important to take into account as well. So one of the most important learnings that I've had during my time at King, doing numerous A/B tests, some more success than others, is the importance of A/B test design. I think that the A/B test design is pivotal, can ensure the success of your A/B test, and it can basically make or break what you can do with the results. So I want to explain to you a little bit more about how we do A/B test design at King and what are the different steps involved. So the first step of designing an A/B test might look straightforward, but it's about setting a hypothesis, formulating your hypothesis. It's important to take into account what are you trying to test and what are you expecting to see as a result, both in terms of KPIs affected and in terms of player behavior or user behavior in other cases. You can make an hypothesis saying, well, I think that feature A will perform better than feature B. That's not maybe the best hypothesis. A better hypothesis would be to say, okay, I think feature A will outperform feature B because it has better social aspect, which might drive users to engage more. Because you're referring to the player behavior and the KPIs that you want to measure, you can actually verify the assumptions underlying your hypothesis, which is very important. We might see that indeed feature A is outperforming feature B, but not of the reasons that we because of the reasons that we thought. Maybe they give much better rewards, which is more engaging to players. So if we then want to optimize this feature or maybe redesign a different feature, we need to know what the player motivations are that underlie this hypothesis. Second step is about creating a testing plan. And this, I think, is a very interesting step in terms of data science, there's quite a bit of modeling involved. First thing you want to be thinking about is who's your audience? Who is going to see this new feature optimization? Maybe it's for new users only, new installs. Maybe it's for the more seasoned players. This is important because you want to know how big is your audience, because that then depends, that then determines your test design, which we get now to the next step, which is the power calculations. And what you want to do with power calculations is decide how big are your test groups, how many test groups do you have, how long does your test need to run for, and what that all depends on your effect size. I want to show you a little tool that's been created by one of my colleagues in Berlin, which is called the Minimum Detectable Effect Calculator. And that's really cool because that can really help you decide how long your test should run for based on which metric you're interested in, how big your group is, what your sample size is, etc. So what you can see here on the left side is, let's say you want to introduce a feature, which might be, you might not be sure how good it will perform. So let's say you only want to roll it out to a small part of your population. You might expect a 2.5% uplift, which is this kind of dotted line here. And this will show, this red line shows you, will you reach that uplift, yes or no? Will you be able to detect that uplift? When you start out at day one, you might not be able to detect it because you don't have enough people in your sample. But as more people are moving in to your test, you might be able to detect a smaller sample. Now, if you have a very small treatment group, you might not reach the required sample size at all. There is 56 days here, and we're still above the 2.5% line. However, what we can then decide is to increase our treatment group in size, and that will help you because you've got bigger sample size, you might be able to detect your expected effect earlier. So here we can see if we've got a large treatment group, we can already, after 10 days, we start to go below the 2.5% line, which means that we are able to detect this effect. And this is very interesting because it means that before you even start your test, you can decide on how long should your test run, and that will help you to eliminate any biases that might be involved in your test. So to go back to the A/B testing design. So there is, we talked a little bit about how long your A/B test should run using power calculations, but there's another side to that, because from a statistical point of view, it's very simple to say, well, after 2 weeks, I'll reach my desired minimal detectable effect, and that's how long the test should run. However, from a business perspective, there's also what impact is your test having on your overall metrics. Let's say you have a feature that you expected to do really well, and suddenly you're seeing a minus 10% decrease in revenue. Do you really want to leave this test running for another 2 weeks? Maybe not, and that's important to decide on that before you actually start your test. If you have to make those kind of decisions during your test, you get a lot of fear-based decision making, and that's not gonna help you from a statistical perspective. If you stop your test too early based on non-significant results, you're gonna really inflate your type 1 error, and I'll talk a little bit about that later. So what I'm suggesting here is to set some stopping rules with your stakeholders to determine this is the maximum decrease usually that we're willing to tolerate in our metrics. If we reach that, we will turn off the test. But if not, even though it might look a little bit negative, we're going to continue the test to make sure to avoid these kind of biases. And then finally, what I've referred to a little bit already is to manage expectations. Usually when you create A/B tests in a business environment, you've got a lot of different stakeholders. I'm working with producers, with designers, with business managers. They all have a different interest in this test, and it's very important to know that they're all on board with the testing plan. They know why it is important what we're testing. They know how long we need to wait before we get results, and they know what the next steps are after we've we run the test, so that we're all on board and we can all make sure that we run this test as it should be running. We don't stop early, for example. Yes, so that's on A-B test design. Another interesting thing I've learned is about Bayesian A-B test analysis. Now, Bayesian A-B test analysis can be quite computationally intensive, especially when you're dealing with large sample sizes. But what we've, so we don't use it very often, but I think that it can be in specific cases super useful. And I like to discuss a little bit about what kind of cases this can be useful. First, a quick check. Who here knows what A-B test, Bayesian analysis is and has worked with this? A few show of hands. Okay, I'll do a really quick explanation of Bayesian analysis. So what we have here is we've got a box, and there are some yellow and black balls in a box. So the question that you're trying to answer here is, what proportion of balls in this box are yellow? That's the question you're trying to answer. Now, you can't really see very well. You might say, okay, I think it's about 50-50. That's called your prior belief. So you can make a nice distribution function that says, okay, centered around 0.5, most likely about half of the balls in there are yellow. Now, what you do next is you take a sample. You take 10 balls out of that box randomly, and you look at what the outcome is. So let's say you took some balls, and you've got 8 yellow ones and 2 black ones. Now, based on that, actually, the most likely proportion of yellow balls in that box is 0.8. And that's what's called the evidence of the, or the like, maximum likelihood distribution. So you've got now two distributions here, one based on your prior beliefs or prior knowledge, and one based on your sample that you just took. And what Bayesian analysis does is it combines these two into what we call a posterior distribution. Does that make sense to everyone? Cool. Okay, so that's Bayesian in a nutshell. Then what are the benefits of using Bayesian analysis in A-B testing analysis? So one of the benefits is evaluating small uplifts. So not always can we detect the uplift that we're interested in with the frequentist framework. That doesn't mean that it's not significant from a business perspective. A 1% uplift in revenue can be really significant from a business perspective and really important that we know to roll this out. Another one, I'm not going to go into detail on that one. The one that I want to go into detail about is about risk measures. So what we do with risk measures is when evaluating a certain metric, we can look not only at is this positive or not, we can look at how big is it? What is the probability of seeing a positive uplift or a negative uplift? And those are risk measures that can be very helpful in evaluating results that you're seeing. So I want to explain this a little bit using referencing an A-B test that we've done back in 2017 in Farm Hero Saga. So what we wanted to do is we wanted to introduce a new feature that would encourage non-payers to engage a little bit more with our game. However, this was a non-tested feature. We've never tried it out before. So it was considered a little bit risky. So we wanted to make sure that we set some benchmarks to what we were looking for. So this is what we came up with. We're looking at a bunch of different metrics. One of them is what we call DAU, or daily average users. So that's basically how much players are in your game daily. So there's two ways of evaluating this when you do an A-B test. First of all, it's a simple frequentist test. We did a one-sided t-test, and we wanted to test that the difference is at least neutral. We used a null hypothesis of no significant difference. And then we came up with a risk measure. So we said, okay, we're willing to tolerate some level of decrease in our metric. Let's say a 1% decrease is acceptable. However, if we want to see, we want to make sure that anything more extreme than that, the probability of that happening is at most 20%. And that's a very interesting way of thinking about A-B test results, because you can really think about it in terms of probability, which is very easy to interpret, actually. Much more easier to interpret than, for example, a frequentist confidence interval. So this is very helpful also when explaining your message to maybe less statistical knowledge people. Using this framework, I did an analysis. I looked at the data. I came up with a posterior distribution. So what you see here is the posterior distribution, which is centered around 0%, which means that most likely there's no difference in daily average users between the treatment and the control group. However, you can see that there is some probability that there's a negative difference, and there's some probability that there's a positive difference. And Bayesian analysis, what it does, rather than give you some like magical number back, it gives you back a sample of the posterior distribution, which is very helpful because it makes it very easy to compute these kind of percentages or do tests with it. So we could very easily calculate, so what is the percentage of observations from the posterior distribution that fell below that -1% uplift line? In this case, it was -17%. So if we go back to our benchmarks, we did a simple frequentist test saying, yes, the difference is neutral, but we also know that the probability that the difference is lower than -1% is actually 17%, which we were happy about, so we then decided to roll this feature out further. And the reason I'm advocating this is because, like I said, it's very easy to interpret the results of a Bayesian analysis, and it's very helpful to sit down with your stakeholders and think about, okay, how much risk are we willing to take? Now, obviously, we also talked about some negatives about A/B testing, and I'd like to share with you some challenges that I faced in the hope that you will learn from that, and when implementing your own A/B test, you'll think about these. Obviously, I don't have the solution, but I think it's important to think about these things when designing A/B tests. The first one I'd like to talk about is interaction effects. We've been dealing with this a lot over the past year. We've had, in our London studio, we've had a redesign of the game team, which meant that suddenly they released features and optimizations so much faster, which was really, really great. And we were very happy with that. But as data scientists, it's hard to keep up with wanting to test all these different features. At the same time, we had a lot of them interacting with each other. So how do we deal with this? In my opinion, there's different ways of dealing with this. None of them are the best way, but I'd like to discuss them, and then all of them might be applicable to different situations. So the first one is very simple. We just set the test up independently. We ignore the interaction effects completely. This obviously is based on the assumption that the interaction effects are weak between the different groups. So by setting them up independently, I mean that the probability of being in a treatment group for test A is completely independent from the probability of being in a treatment group for test B. This means that we maximize sample size because all of our users are included in all of the tests. And it's quite a realistic context if you think about it, because in reality, whenever users are playing a game, there's lots of different things going on at the same time, different features, time-limited events, maybe some sales. So it's never a clean environment. So if you make your environment a little bit too clean during an A/B test, it might not be realistic. However, the negative is quite obvious. If there are interaction effects, if your assumption is wrong, then you're going to get some skewed effects. And this is very important to think about beforehand. So the second option is to set up one big test with all the different interactions in its own case. This can be very interesting, but also very difficult if you've got multiple tests or tests with a lot of different treatment groups. Then this can become quite a big test. You can get the most accurate learnings because you're having all the different interactions in different cases. However, you only get the learnings if you actually have the sample sizes big enough. And that's the problem with this method, is that because you have so many different cases, it's quite likely that the sample size in each individual case is quite small, and you might not be able to detect the uplift that you're looking for. The final case is deliver the test to different parts of the player base. So what you can do is you can say, okay, 50% of my player base will be exposed to test A, the other 50% of my player base will be exposed to test B, and I'll just look at them individually. So this is not really a good thing to put in this slide, because really what we're doing is not, we're not looking at the interaction effects. We've got really accurate learnings for the performance of the individual tests. And if one of those tests has more than one treatment group, you'll have bigger sample sizes than the second option here. However, you have no learnings on the interaction effects. This can be appropriate if you've got different features or optimizations that will not be shown to the same players at the same time. In that case, it can be actually quite appropriate to do this. So those are kind of the three ways I know of dealing with interaction effects. There might be more, and I'd be very happy to hear from you guys for any other suggestions. The second one I'd like to talk about is peaking. So as we all know, in a business, we want to know results as soon as possible. So once we've set up a test, we, even after a week or a day, we want to know, right, how is it doing? We want to make sure that everything looks good, that our metrics might be improving, and we're going to have a quick look at the results. Now, this in itself is not a problem. However, the problem becomes when you see the results, you might not be happy with it or very happy with it, and then you then decide to act on them. You might decide to stop the test, you might decide to roll it out, and this is where the problem comes in. So what this is called is called peaking. So before you reach the sample size that you need, you look at the results and you decide to stop or roll out based on that. And the problem with this is that you're inflating your false positive rate, which means that your false positive rate is basically the probability of detecting a significant difference, even if there is none. And by inflating that means that you're at risk of making decisions based on no difference. So how to illustrate this point, my colleague Xin Yu has done some really cool simulations. And what he's done 10,000 simulations on two groups. So we're basically testing control versus treatment. And 15,000 players in each group, so reasonable sample size. And because we're doing simulations, we know exactly the underlying distribution of the data, and we know that there is an equal conversion rate in each of the groups, which means that really we shouldn't be detecting any significance here. However, false positive rate means that it is potentially possible due to some random selection, just randomness, that you will detect a significant uplift even if there is none. Usually we set the false positive rate to 0.05, is quite a usual number that people use. So what happens if you don't peak? You wait for the entire duration of the test and then you look at the results. Well, obviously, your false positive rate will stay the same. It's still 0.05, no problem there whatsoever. However, what happens if you peak? So this is the results from the simulations and simulating how often we can peak. So on the x-axis, we see the number of peaks, and on the y-axis, we see the type 1 error. And we see that go up quite significantly. So even after one peak, before you reach your sample size, we already increase the type 1 error or the false positive rate to 0.08, which means that if you do that test many times, in 8% of the cases, you'll see a significant difference, even though we know that there's no significant difference. If you peak 10 times, that goes up to 0.2, which means 1 in 5 is a lot. And the reason that this happens is because we're violating the assumption of fixed sample size. Obviously, if you peak before you've reached your sample size that you're looking for, you don't have a fixed sample size, and that's a violation of the frequentist assumption. And in a business that does a lot of A/B tests, that can be quite risky. If we make false decisions in 1/5 of the cases, that's a lot, and that's a problem here. So those are kind of my learnings that I wanted to share with you guys. So to sum it all up, A/B test design, very important, can ensure the success of your A/B test. The three steps that I think are the most important are formulate your hypothesis, create your testing plan, and don't forget to inform and manage expectations of your stakeholders. Secondly, Bayesian analysis, even though computationally quite intensive, it can still help you when you try to evaluate small uplifts that might be important from a business perspective, and to create some risk measures which are easy for people to interpret and that help you to evaluate the risk associated with a certain feature or optimization. Finally, interaction effects, very important to think about this. They can skew your results, so always consider them in your testing plan. How do you deal with them? And the fourth one, the final one, is peaking. Peaking and stopping at a significant result is not a good idea. You will inflate your false positive rate, so always stick to your stopping rules. If you do want to peak, there is a way of correcting for it, but usually try not to peak. So yeah, those are my my key takeaways. I hope this has all been useful, and I think I've got time for some questions.
Great, thanks, Jessica. Anybody like to start with a question? Right, okay.
Thank you very much. Hi. You mentioned a testing framework. What do you use in particular?
What do you mean with testing framework?
Like, how do you make sure that half the people you choose
right.
get one version, the other?
That's a good point. So we have developed in-house a testing framework, which obviously shows the kind of upfront investment that you'll need to make if you want to do proper A/B testing. So what we do, based on some ID, we'll hash them and then randomly assign them, which means that we ensure random selection and we don't have like potential selection bias there. But this is an in-house solution that we have.
Hi.
Hi.
Thanks a lot for the talk. It was great. When I think of King, the games that you produce are played all over the world, right?
Yeah.
And you could imagine that the same tests might lead to different results in different countries, or even within one country. You know, London might behave differently than Edinburgh or so.
Yeah.
Do you currently do anything for treatment effect heterogeneity, and how do you do it?
That's a very good point. Yes, you're totally right. People in different countries behave completely different. What we do in general is it very much, we don't have one general solution. It very much depends on the situation. Sometimes we decide to sort of ignore that heterogeneity and feel like, okay, just gonna do whatever is best for the majority. In some cases, we are actually interested in differences between countries. If you look at monetization, for example, can be much better in other countries. So we try to kind of focus on what we think, it's not really a great answer. We focus on the what is most important in a particular situation, and we do take it into account, especially when doing a test in a particular geographical area. We need to make sure that if we want to generalize those results, we need to take into account that it might not be representative of the entire population. So those are things that we do take into account. There's not really one way of how we do this, but yeah, this is definitely a challenge that we have.
Hi, I guess on a related note, how do you deal with, or do you have to deal with seasonality, perhaps even inter-week seasonality?
Yes, seasonality is quite strong. Inter-week is one, but also throughout the year. We might see peaks at holidays. So those are interesting questions. What we try to do when doing A/B testing is ensuring that we pick a long enough time period to kind of make sure that we rule out the inter-week seasonality. That's something we do, and whenever we do like forecasting or prediction, we also take those into account when we create our model.
Okay, looks like we've finished with the questions there.
Cool.
Let's just thank Jessica again.